Well, I want to thank you for joining us for this Sunday. It is the 10th Sunday after the Pentecost, so we are really deep into the season right now, and I hope you've kind of got the idea that God is calling us to grow in our relationship with Him, and I hope that you've taken advantage of this opportunity to do so in your life, in your relationship with God, and in your relationship with one another. So today we start a series of lessons. You're going to have to guess what they're about. But the next 4 weeks will be fixated on bread. And so we might make you a little bit hungry over the course of the next few weeks. But that, of course, is a very important theme in the Gospel of John, that Jesus is the bread of life. So, oops, I just gave you the hint of what we're going to be looking at today. You'll also notice a couple of things. We do have a little presentation here of small portion of food that people in our congregation have brought. The only reason for that is we want to try to tie in our gifts that we give to feed the world with the gift of the bread of life. And you're going to see how we do that later in the service today. If you do come to one of our services over the next 4 weeks, we ask that you bring one item on our list of things that we need. Right now we're doing a lot of feeding of single men, it seems, and so a lot of the families have been able to recuperate a lot of their losses and have been able to become employed and are feeding their families right now. So we've had a lot of success in our community with helping families through their difficult challenges. But we seem to have a handful of families, and in particular a lot of single men, who are going through some chronic difficulties financially at this time. And we are helping them the best we can with food and assistance as we're able. Your gifts help with that, but I need you to understand that these gifts are part of the way God has called us to feed the world. And we're going to connect that to the bread of life here today. So as a part of our service, if you come to one of our in-person worship services over the next 4 weeks, we are asking you to bring an offering. It doesn't have to be a big offering. It could just be a single microwavable dinner that after we partake of communion, we are going to bring as a gift of thanksgiving and offer to God so that that gift might be a blessing to feed this world. So that's what we're asking you to do. That's what this visual presentation is for. And we're going to show you how that works. And we hope that you take opportunity to do that and as a part of your life and your devotional practices over these next 4 weeks. Okay, I know that I promised you last week that we were going to have a board meeting very shortly about our worship practices and how we're going to approach the fall. That actually happened, from your perspective, yesterday. But from my perspective, that's tomorrow. So that kind of tells you when I'm filming this. Today is Friday. I'm filming it for Sunday. Our board meeting is on Saturday. I do not have information to report to you this week about what our worship is going to look like, but I do tell you this. We are planning on probably being cautious as we possibly can, especially with this new variant of COVID that is now extant and really running rampage through our country right now. We want to be cautious because we want to protect you, and if we have to be patient for a few more months, we will. We do have in-person worship, but for now, we're still probably going to be asking you to mask when you come to an inside worship service. Outside, we're a little bit more free about that. We still expect people to keep their distance from one another. We're still not back to that full fellowship as we'd like. However, indoors, we are probably still going to be expecting masks. I will tell you that next week, but my gut reaction is that's what the board is going to decide. That's kind of been the talk that we've been discussing. Okay, let us prepare our hearts for worship. So we invite you to turn your hearts and your attention to a time of contemplation, repentance, and an announcement of God's forgiveness. We begin our service in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us approach God with a true heart and full assurance of God's power to heal and to forgive us. Merciful God, you have loved your people from the beginning of time, desiring that we also love you and our neighbor with fullness of heart. We confess that we often seek wealth or security for ourselves without acting generously towards others. Forgive us and point us in your ways that we might reflect your will for us and your creation. God has promised that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. As an ordained minister of the Church of Christ by his authority, I declare to you pardon and forgiveness of all your sin. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory, Lord Jesus Christ, holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us, you are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us and we eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this entire world with its need and with the life that comes only from you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first lesson for today is found in the book of Ephesians, the first chapter. St. Paul writes, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beg you to lead a life that is worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? For he who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, to equip the saints for the working of the ministry, for building up of the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Jesus Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown by about every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful schemings. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into Him, who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. Here ends the lesson. Our psalm is Psalm 78. We read again responsibly. You're welcome to join as I indicate every other frame. God commanded the skies above and opened up the doors of heaven. God rained down upon them manna to eat and gave them the grain of heaven. Man ate of the bread of the angels. He sent them food in abundance. God caused the east wind to blow in the heavens, and by his power he let out the south wind. God rained flesh upon them like dust, winged birds like the sand of the seas. God let them fall in the midst of their camps, all around their habitations. They ate, and they were filled. Our gospel lesson for this Sunday is found in the book of John, the 6th chapter. Glory be to you, O Lord. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into small boats and came to Capernaum and looked for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered them and said, "Truly I tell you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate some of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that lasts for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him the Father has set his seal." Therefore they said to him, "What are we to do so that we may accomplish the work of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." So they said to him, "What then are you doing as a sign that we might see and believe you? What work are you performing?" "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat." Jesus then said, "Truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you this bread from heaven. It is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the entire world." So then they said, "Lord, always give us this bread." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. One who comes to me will not be hungry. One who believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks again for this lesson of this word that you would speak to us. A message of hope and salvation. For we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. And once again, are welcome to take your handout, which is posted on our Facebook page underneath the announcement for today's service in the comments section. In case we've not been clear about that, sometimes people find it tricky to find. It isn't all that tricky. Go to our Facebook page. Doesn't matter whether it's our Holy Trinity page or Revolution Church page. They're both the same thing. And look for the announcement for today's service and what it's about. And look in the comments section. You will see two JPEGs that you can download and print out for yourself and fill out if you'd like before, during the service, or afterwards. I was going to say before. You can always try filling it out before and see if you're right. That would be fantastic, too. Kind of read my mind, I guess. Well, let's take a look at today's lesson. I remember last week we spent a great deal of time looking at why the lectionary authors, the people who put together a lectionary that we read for Sunday, really didn't do us a whole lot of favors because they kind of messed up and butchered a little bit of the 6th chapter of the book of Mark. And now here we are in John. How do we skip from Mark to John? Usually we just read from one gospel for an entire year, and for the most part we do read from the Gospel of Mark. But we take this diversion to the Gospel of John because today's lesson is actually very similar to the lesson that followed up the feeding of the 5,000 to 10,000 or so that we read in our lesson for last week. So, as I said, we're now leaving Mark's narrative. As I mentioned to you, Jesus just fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. That same story is both in the Gospel of Mark chapter 6 and also here in the Gospel of John chapter 6. All right? And now, so after the following of the miraculous feeding, we have today's lesson in John, a very similar lesson where Jesus and the disciples in Mark leave and everybody kind of goes across the sea to find them because they want what Jesus is offering. The difference is, and I think this is the reason why the lectionary folks chose this, because in the Gospel of John, Jesus mentions that he is the bread of life. Now, this is not something you see in the Gospel according to Mark. Mark never tells us who Jesus is. Remember how I said that when reading the Gospel of Mark? Mark wants you to try to figure out who Jesus is by showing us who Jesus is. John, however, kind of takes a sledgehammer and bashes us with the head and it says, "This is who Jesus is, dummies, in case you can't figure it out." And so in this case, we are told who Jesus is. He is the bread of life. And what that means, hang tight, because that's what today's lesson is all about. The thing is, people were seeking Jesus because their bellies were filled, and their diseases and sicknesses are being cured. And they think that Jesus is the great big Santa Claus in the sky who's going to give them everything they want and everything that they desire. So this is why, and this is the motivation for a lot of people following him. They want what Jesus has. And so John, the gospel writer John, uses today's lesson to demonstrate in a very similar way that Mark distinguishes between two types of healing. The physical cure that we receive that's only temporary, and the true healing that Jesus wants to begin in our lives today that lasts for an eternity. John does the same thing, but he does it with the feeding, the bread. Remember how I mentioned to you last week, if you watched last week's sermon, that it was a Holy Communion service that Jesus was feasting with them. He was introducing to them what this meal was all about and how they were coming to feast upon him, something bigger. There's something behind this meal that they partook of. So, as I said, Mark wants to know the distinction between physical cures and healing. Cures, again, are only temporary. Healing is a permanent status in our relationship with God that begins now in our lives and lasts to eternity. But John, in his feeding of the 5,000, wants us to know that there's something else going on behind the scenes in the feeding of the 5,000. John wants us to know that there is a distinction between earthly food, materialistic food that we eat, and the heavenly food that God is trying to give to us. Now, I can tell you, we are in a very liberal denomination. Our ELCA tends to be politically and also theologically. And sometimes it leads our pastors and some of our bishops to think that just feeding the poor or caring for the needy is doing the good work of God. It is, by the way, a good work of God. I'm not denying that. But we also have to tell them about Jesus. We need to do both. Because God wants to do more than just feed their bodies. He wants to transform their lives. Jesus goes on and tells them this. Those who come to get what Jesus is offering. He says, you know, earthly food, it decays. But I have food that will never decay. Oh, they're really excited now. Because, you know, you grab an apple or an orange or you grab a piece of fruit and you set it out for too long, what does it do? It decays. It becomes black. It starts to stink. Certainly not something you want to eat. You throw it out to your rubbish pile. You throw it out to you crush it up or you rip it up and you throw it in your garden. Feed your garden. Whatever it is you do with the food that decays and so forth. Well, the crowd likes this idea of food that doesn't decay. And so they just say, Jesus, always give us this food. In other words, every single day, they're hoping that Jesus will be again their Santa Claus in the sky, that he's going to come every single day and multiply food like he did with the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus, that would be great. We'd never have to go to work again. How fantastic would that be? So they want Jesus to provide them with daily food, like they were provided with manna in the wilderness. I don't want to go into too many details about that story, but that is an Old Testament lesson from the book of Exodus. After the Jews were released from captivity, they had nothing to eat. They said, why did God bring us out in the wilderness just to die? And so they kind of were accusing Moses of bringing them out to die. And so God provided them bread from heaven, manna, that they feasted on every day until they got sick of it. They said, can't you give us more than manna? And then God gave them quail. So they had plenty of meat to eat. Then they got sick of quail. Just like us humans, we always complain. God provides us free stuff, and we complain about it, right? So anyway, they were expecting Jesus to feed them every day so that they could feast on this meal. But Jesus goes on to tell them, if you feast upon me, you will be satisfied. Maybe not physically, you'll still have that hunger in your belly, but you'll be satisfied. You will no longer need to go and seek spiritual nourishment elsewhere, not from your rabbi or the priests in Jerusalem, not from any other preacher on the street. You will receive everything that you need to nourish you for the rest of your life. So let me tell you the function of this story. It is a commentary on the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus is giving us a glimpse of what he's trying to tell us about how he wants to interact with us in this life. Remember, the healing stories of Mark, the purpose wasn't to cure the body. The curing of the body was a sign of what he really wants to do, is heal us and our relationship with God. So the exact same thing is taking place in the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus wants them to look up and realize that there's something deeper going on here. So Jesus, again, didn't come to tend just to the world's materialistic needs. These are miracles, and they are signs that point to the truth and reality of what God wants to do in our lives, which is, number two, transform our relationship with God. That is what this meal is all about. So in the gospel lessons of John, these next 4 weeks we are going to be looking at them. They're called the Bread of Life lessons. It's another means of communicating the same thing Mark did about the healing and the restoration of God, what God wants to do in our lives, how God truly wants to transform us. Now, for us Lutherans, we got the message. I know not every denomination does, and that's okay, because we're not going to be divided because of the fact that we disagree about our systematic theologies, okay? But we Lutherans understand this meal of Holy Communion as being important to our relationship with God, because it's exactly what Jesus was doing at the feeding of the 5,000, what Jesus did in the Last Supper. He's trying to tell us that he's giving to us to feast, not just a physical materialistic meal, but through that materialistic meal of bread and wine, or in the case of the feeding of 5,000, the fish and the bread, we are ultimately feasting on something more significant, which is Jesus. So Holy Communion, we understand, is a sign that Jesus left behind for us as the church that ultimately points us to the work of God in our lives. And so we partake of it often. Now, I know there are a lot of denominations. Maybe you're joining us from another denomination, and maybe Assemblies of God or Baptist or whatever. And you say, well, once a quarter we take communion. We don't want to destroy it. Well, okay, you tell that to your wife. Honey, I'm only going to tell you I love you once a quarter, because if we do it any more than that, if I say I love you any more than once a quarter, it's just going to destroy the meaning of the word love, isn't it? Well, that would be stupid. I think your wife might smack you in the face, okay? You say love every single day. I love you every single day. It doesn't lose its meaning. Sometimes it's a rote thing. You just do it. But it's important, because even in those days where you're just, I don't necessarily feel squishy for you, but I'm here. That means I'm committed to you. And that, to me, is probably the most comforting days, is when you hear it when the person doesn't necessarily feel it. So every Sunday we partake of this meal, don't always feel squishy in our stomach for God, but it's a reminder from God that he has not removed his promise and his love from us. And he promises to be with us, to deepen our relationship with him and one another. So the gift of grace comes to us, God's love, through these signs of bread and wine. Holy Communion, however, I'm going to flip back, it doesn't preclude us from physically feeding the world either. Notice that Jesus did both. He fed them spiritually, but he also fed them physically. This, I think, is the problem with liberal denominations and with conservative denominations. Conservative denominations are concerned about feeding people's souls, and that's great, but they forget about feeding the poor. Liberal denominations feed the poor physically, materialistically, but don't believe that they have any requirement to tell them about Jesus. We need both, because this is what Jesus does. He ties the two together, okay? So while the gift of reconciliation with God is the primary purpose why Jesus Christ has come into this world, he does still care about our materialistic needs. And the world's needs and the world's physical hunger is still in God's purview. So God's feeding of the hungry is a sign of God's intention to nurture and care for them. When a poor person receives food enough to eat in the name of Jesus Christ, it is a sacramental type of thing, because we're telling them that this is a sacrament of what God wants to also do in your life for an eternity. It is an important sign for a poor person's belly to be filled, so they can then have the opportunity to hear about what Jesus wants to do for them into an eternity. After all, it's impossible for a person to hear and understand God's love when they are starving to death. So it is imperative for the church to understand that one of our primary purpose is obviously letting people know about Jesus. How do we do that? It is by feeding them physically so that that can be alleviated, so then they can hear about what Jesus wants to do for their eternity. Our feasting upon Christ in the Eucharistic meal transforms our lives for those of us who are Christians, so that we know that we have the privilege then of participating in this reconciliation by the feeding of those who are physically hungry, so that they then also have the opportunity to hear about Jesus. Both and. Now, I don't mean that in a cynical way. We feed them just so we can get another notch in our belt and bring them to Christ. No, it's a both and thing. We feed them, and sometimes the feeding is kind of an end in of itself. But you also take opportunity when you can to witness to them. We give this to you out of love, the love that God has placed in our hearts. You want it? I'll tell you about Jesus. You don't? I'm just going to keep feeding you. Because that's what Jesus would have us do. So in essence, the canned goods that we all bring during our worship service, or you send to us during the week, and we bring to the church and we distribute to the poor, are sacramental in nature. Every canned good you bring is a sacrament that we set apart in the name of God that brings Jesus into the homes into whom we give this food. They carry the love of Jesus Christ with them. That's what Holy Communion does. That's what the bread and the wine does. It carries with it Jesus Christ and his promise for us. When we offer these gifts, we are offering Jesus. And these canned goods, this loaf of bread, brings Jesus Christ into their homes. So I'm going to assign you something to do. Over these next 3 weeks, I hope you will take the opportunity to come to church. If you can't come, if you're still concerned about it, or you live in another state somewhere, and you'd like to just send us a loaf of bread, send us a canned good, send us a canister or a jar of jelly or something, or peanut butter, whatever it is, something that our folks in our community will use, a microwavable meal. Wouldn't that be fantastic? It's a way to show that you understand that you've been fed by God, and you are offering this microwavable meal as a sacramental gift to feed somebody in Jesus' name. We're going to sing a song right now. We don't have that opportunity. We don't have Holy Communion here as a part of our time together here. We do that on Sunday. We do it every Tuesday. But after our song, we're going to bring a little offering just to show you what we are going to be doing after we receive Holy Communion. We're going to offer those gifts as a gift of thanksgiving. Jesus, thank you for feeding me. And now use this gift to feed the world. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the feeding of the world that you've done, for the sign of your love, the food that you provide, the physical, tangible, materialistic food, which on this side of the kingdom is important for us. We need that food, God, and there are many who don't have it. It is imperative that we as a church take seriously that it is our responsibility. We need to stop waiting for government to do it. We need to feed people right now. We're in our backyard, we're in our community, those people that we can see and touch and feel. Here's a sign of Jesus' love. That's something government can't do. So help us, God, to use the privilege, the opportunity we have to feed the world for your name's sake. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a good old bluegrass song. I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to play it very bluegrass. It is, believe it or not, a traditional hymn that's a bluegrass song. It comes from Appalachia, and so...
and wandering here in the truth, we will be fed.
Time in our service you ever have the opportunity to come to our in-person service, that we participate in a service of Holy Communion. We will not be doing that obviously here today, but after we've received a refreshment from Jesus Christ, from those signs of bread and wine, we will then have the privilege and the opportunity to bring gifts of food to bless our community, that this food might enter into their homes, that Jesus might enter their homes under the signs of a microwavable meal. How fantastic is that? So I'm going to take this opportunity to offer a gift. It is not one that I gave. It's a member of our church who gave it to me. And so I'm going to take this opportunity to place it on our continuing and growing offering here at the foot of the altar table. Let us confess together our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, it is with great gratitude that we come before you today, knowing that we have been filled with your presence through your word, through your sacrament. We give you thanks that you keep announcing to us over and over again, on a daily basis, through simple acts of grace and mercy, your intention to love us and have relationship with us for all eternity. This is not just for us, it is for the entire world. And so we ask you to continue to inspire us that we might be a blessing for those who are hurting physically, for those who are hungry, whose stomachs are gnawing with pain because they just have not had enough food, not just today, but yesterday and the day before and the next month ahead of them. They face a difficult challenge and just a slow death by starvation. This should not take place in this world. You have provided sufficient food that every man, woman, and child could have three meals a day. And so we ask your forgiveness that we, our politics, our stinginess, have prevented this food from being distributed to those who are in desperate need. God, let us seek opportunity to feed those who are hungry, to bring Jesus into their lives. But God is not just that gnawing physical emptiness in their stomach. As I mentioned, there are people who are physically struggling with illness and disease. And they too are having a difficult time finding God in their circumstances. For those who've had broken relationships, for those who've had misfortune in other ways, financially, the loss of jobs, and some of their security. We pray that you would continue to surround them and use us, God, where we are able to help alleviate their burdens. Whatever else is on our hearts and minds, we take a moment of silent prayer to lift all of those concerns before you. Into your hands, O Lord, we commit all those for whom we pray, and we trust in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the Lord's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.